from Rice University, where every student gets a front row seat. It's General Physics 2. Today, electric potential of conductors and capacitors. Dr. Stenson. Also, a painful demonstration. And now, a man who was gifted some succulents, but they tasted terrible. Professor Hafner.
Good preview of what this lecture is going to be like. All right, here we go. So, what are we talking about? Yes, talking about electric fields. Last week in forces, and Tuesday, electric potential. All right, so a charge makes a forces, and force per unit charge is a field. And yesterday, or Tuesday, we talked about these force interactions mean you got to do work, so there's also an energy associated with it. And that energy per unit charge is the potential. Potential energy per unit charge is potential. So that's what's going on. And we did examples last time with point charges. And we sort of saved uniform field things until today, because today we're going to talk about capacitors. And that really is where you see the uniform field all the time, as you will see. I noticed that the Canvas homework for next week is due on Wednesday, but sprinkle day, Tuesday's a sprinkle day, so I'll move it to Thursday, because nothing can be due on a sprinkle day or the day after a sprinkle day. Cool. And I think that's it. So yeah, I won't, yeah, so no lecture Tuesday. I'm the only person that likes sprinkle day. The university is the only place where everybody is upset about a day off, but whatever. All right, so today, here we go. So we are going to talk about uniform fields and capacitors. But first, we have to talk about fields in and around conductors. A few little things. Now you may say, what about the potential? Potential is also a field. All right, so the electric field is a field, and the potential technically is a field. Although often we talk about it just at a certain point. So potential difference, volts, these are all different things we say. They're kind of about the same thing. So here we're going to talk about electric fields and potential in and around conductors. I'm just going to draw two drawings here. We're going to do a few bullets here. This all could be proven with deep discussions of physics and calculus. I'm really just going to tell you what you need to know. This, you know, we don't really need to go on and belabor this too much. Imagine we had a uniform electric field. So you want to get used to the idea of seeing that and saying, that's a uniform electric field, pointing to the right. Uniform electric field E. Now, what if we put a neutral conductor in here? I'm going to write N-E-U-C-O-N, a neutral conductor, just to remind you later. What would happen? So you may remember before we talked about the difference between conductors and insulators. Conductors have those free charges. Charge is free to move. So quiz yourself real quick. How is the charge going to separate in that neutral conductor? I'll give you 10 seconds.
Do you want to know what it is?
That's how long you get. All right, so let's see, electric field this way. The free electrons are going to go this way. And if you weren't sure how to know that, one is just remember that positive charge goes along the field. Or think about the charges that made this field. It always goes positive to negative. So the electric field lines are coming away from a positive plate. So the electrons will be attracted to the positive plate. Or the way we define the electric field is we imagine a positive test charge would go that way. The force would be that way. Therefore, a negative charge would go this way. If this thing were neutral, negative charge here means we must have left positive charge here. And you say, we've already talked about this. Why are you wasting my time? You're paying me too. That's the reason. But the other reason is we didn't talk about how much charge is going to go to the ends. All of it? No, not all of it, because then the whole metal would break down. What about all of the free electrons? Not necessarily. Basically, it's going to go until E inside of here is zero. Because what's making it move? We had an electric field, we dump a metal, a neutral conductor in there. Suddenly there's an electric field inside this neutral conductor. Charge goes this way, charge goes that way. What happens when you have charge this way and charge that way? What is that going to make? That's going to make a little electric field due to this charge separation. Which way is it going to point? So this positive charge, external field, make it go that way. But if we're just thinking about the field made by the separated, the polarized charge, it's going to go this way. So the metal makes a little bit of a field the other way to cancel the external field. Well, if it doesn't make enough to completely cancel it, there's still a net field this way. So the charge continues to separate. So basically the charge continues to separate until it cancels the field on the inside. So that's one of our rules. We're just going to write three rules. If you want to just accept them, you can accept them. I'm just trying to explain them to you. Static E inside a conductor is zero. Because if it weren't zero, the charges will move. That's it. Now you could say, what if you applied a field so big that all the free electrons weren't able to cancel it? Then you're getting into a regime beyond what we're talking about. But if you apply a big enough electric field to a material, you can evaporate it. It's called field evaporation. I've done it, I've seen it on a microscopic scale. Yeah, big enough electric field, free electrons can't pull it off, you'll start to rip atoms apart. Then you can evaporate things with fields. Okay, so that's one thing we know. Let's look at now, what if you had a big old charge here, a point charge now. So its field lines want to go off. And here we put a block of neutral conductor. You could ask yourself, what are these field lines going to do? So first let me tell you what they do, and then we'll justify it. So this field line will go, and it'll just hit that. It'll hit the metal like that. Let's think about the metal first. So in the metal, you will get polarized again. It's not a uniform field, but there's still clearly a field going this way due to this charge Q. So it's not as simple, but that's what's going to happen. So the negative electrons, free electrons in the conductor are going to be attracted over here, and you'll get them coming that way, which means you'll leave positive over there. And just, it won't be as uniform. Like here you could think of it as a constant charge density here, a constant charge density here, because everything's symmetric. Here you might get some weird distribution, but whatever. But you know that the negatives will go this way, positive will go that way. They'll go until E equals zero inside. But let's think about what happens to the field lines of this charge. So they go and they, you know, a positive test charge will run away from this charge and it'll go want to touch these negatives, right? So you got one field line doing that. Another field line will go out, test charge will say, I want to get away from the plus Q, but well, look at all this nice little negative charge here. It'll do that, maybe something like that. This field line, who knows, maybe it'll go there. What actually happens is not something you can just solve with simple equations, right? You have to solve the Laplace equation or something, I don't remember. It'll do something like that. So, you know, you could do a computational numerical solution to this geometry, but it's not something you can just write an equation for. A cube next to a sphere, right? It'd be very complicated. But the key thing I drew here, what happens is that the field lines terminate perpendicular to the surface. Okay, so for two, I'm going to say E is always perpendicular to the conductor surface. And we can justify that in a way similar to how we justified this. Because now, let's just for a minute imagine something crazy happened, all right? So here we have this conductor. So here we're zooming in here. And what if an electric field line didn't come in perpendicular to the surface? What does that mean? Let's see. Let's imagine it's that direction. Well, what does a field line doing that mean? It means there's an electric field here doing that. There's your E, not perpendicular to the conductor surface. So, well, okay, what does that mean? Well, that means we could break it into two components, one that way and one that way. You say, okay, can this happen, EY and EX? Can that happen at the surface? Well, let's see, what would happen to the electron or the free charges in the conductor? Some would be pushed, they would be pushed this way, right? And that's okay, that's why they build up, because they can't leave. Okay, so electrostatics can push the free charges around in the conductor, but it can't push them out of the conductor. Quantum mechanics, let's not worry about it. But what about this field? What is it gonna do? Let's see, E field that way, a little negative charge that way. Okay, it's gonna push it the opposite way. But the point is, the free charges can move laterally, and they're gonna move until they drive this to zero. Okay, so the electric field is always perpendicular to the surface because E perpendicular has to be zero, for the same reason that the total E inside has to be zero. Okay, so these are both surface, referring to surface fields. Here, this field inside in the bulk. So zero everywhere, it's parallel to the surface, value is zero, but you can't have an E perpendicular to the surface. If we drew one more field line here, it would look like that. Right, go right up to the surface. So if we put one and two together, what does it mean in terms of potential? Think about that for a minute. What if I were to walk around the surface? Should that be E parallel or E perpendicular that equals zero? The E parallel has to be zero. If there were any parallel electric field, the charges will redistribute to start canceling it and drive it to zero. You probably figured out when I said it again. E can have a value perpendicular. So I could also write E perpendicular does not equal zero. So that one can be greater than zero. It could be zero if there's no fields anywhere there. Okay? So I'm really just giving you a little bit of physical insight into why these two things are true. But then the big physical insight relevant to this lecture and to electronics is, what do these mean about the potential? What does this tell us about the surface of a conductor? Well, let's imagine that all the field lines we draw, no matter what happens, they can't do that. Feel like it can't cross itself. Don't worry, I know that bothered you. Yeah. So what if I were a little test charge and I was being taken on a walk? Okay, a little test charge, short and stout on the leash, and I walk around here, and I walk around here. How much external work does my pet owner, have to do to take me on this walk? None, right? Because I'm walking parallel to the surface, but the electric field is all perpendicular to the surface. So if we don't have to do any external work, that means the potential energy is constant. And if I have a constant charge, well, the potential energy per my charge is constant, which means the potential around the surface is constant, which means it's an equipotential surface. There you go. So the potential on the surface of a conductor is, you might want to say zero. It doesn't have to be zero. It doesn't really mean anything for it to be zero. Or it's really just changes in potential that really matter. So you could define it as zero what you want. The key is that it's constant. And the reason is, if you move around it, you're always moving perpendicular to a field. So this is really all we care about. The voltage of the surface of a conductor is a constant. Now, extra credit, what happens to the potential when you go inside the conductor? We don't really need to know this. While I'm erasing, I'll think. I'll let you think about that. What is the potential as you go inside the conductor? The potential as you go inside the conductor is the same constant as the surface, right? If you're walking along the surface, you're not having to push against any fields, you're at some potential energy, you walk in, you don't have to push against any fields, same potential energy. So the surface and the bulk are really at the same constant, but that's okay. Okay, so we did that. So now you know kind of what happens on a metal. Now I got to tell you about another object. This is kind of like zoology today. I'm just telling you about objects. It's like I won't say. I don't like to be obnoxious about other fields of science. That's okay. It's awesome. So a battery, right? Oh, I have like an air filter thing here. All right, let's talk about batteries. Okay, because we're heading towards circuits. So we gotta have something to give us, to make the circuit go. Okay, so let's just define it first. A battery is an electrochemical device that holds two conducting electrodes at a constant potential difference or voltage. Okay, no matter what. It just holds it there. How does it do it? How does it hold it there? Through the power of chemistry. Unfortunately, it's electrochemistry, and no one really understands. There's a few fields that I don't understand because no one can teach them. One is genetics, and one is electrochemistry, okay? With all we've learned about genetics, you pick up a book and say, I'm gonna get the fundamentals down about genetics and really understand it. And it starts talking about peas and what color the flower of the pea is. And I'm like, where's the DNA? Can't they just freaking explain it? And this means they don't really know. Electrochemistry, the same thing. Should be easy to explain. Oh my God, pick up an electrochemistry book. No idea what's going on. And then you ask a chemist, can you explain? Well, yeah, the Nernst equation, they write it down. No, can you explain what's going on? No idea. Okay, electrochemistry, genetics. Roasted. Okay, here we go. Let's talk about a battery, though. That's why we're here. We came here to hear about a battery. So here's a battery. Most batteries you look at are like A, and C, and D. But this is, these are still around, but they're less used, a 9-volt battery. And what's cool about a 9-volt battery is the electrodes are right next to each other. So they're really dangerous. The electrodes are right next to each other, and they can put out a lot of current really fast. So that's probably why they don't use them much anymore, is they're dangerous. I don't know if you've ever done this. Who has ever tested a 9-volt battery with their tongue? Let me know in the chat. Have you ever tested one with your tongue? If you want to taste electricity, you put your tongue on it. And it's all tingly. And that's how you know if the battery's good. Yes, you have. Okay, so in person, they're always like, no. So at the end of class, I always pass it around with some little alcohol swabs. Yeah, so do that. Never put it in your pocket, okay? Because if a 9-volt goes across your keys, you'll get this big spark in your pocket, okay? So this 9-volt battery, here's the two electrodes. See the little things on the front there? Two little electrodes. It's gonna hold those at a constant delta V. What does it taste like? That's harder to say. I don't think it really, it doesn't taste like anything. It more feels like tingly pain. I like it. Oh, let's move on. Let's see. So one of them looks like that, and one of them looks like that, because that's how they hook up to things. And if it was like 1870, there would be a thing on here that says script looking E equals 9 volts. Okay. The little smaller one is the positive electrode. The wide one is the negative electrode. Okay. So let's tell you a few things about batteries. One, E means EMF. And don't even bother to write it. It stands for electromotive force. It's a word that was invented before they understood what was going on. Okay. So it's not really creating a force. But anyway, that's what that script E means. And it is, means EMF, it's the delta V, you know what that means, the potential difference between the electrodes. So this battery's job is to hold the difference between this and this at 9 volts, because it's a 9-volt battery, okay? Your little cylindrical AA, AAA hold 1.5 volts or it's less, whatever it is. And they don't put out a lot of current. Oops, I sort of combined two bullets there. Yeah, so it holds delta V between the electrodes. And the other thing is you pick where the potential is zero. So remember we talked about how potential energy is always changes. So you have to pick somewhere. We all have to agree what's zero. For a point charge, the natural place to make zero is infinitely far away, where all the forces and fields are gone. For here, the natural place to call zero is the negative electrode. That's just, that's like ground, you know, because this is for circuits. So we call that zero. So here, this would be 0V, this would be 9V. Right? 0 volts, 9 bolts.
Cool.
Let's see. You pick where vehicles are. Usually the negative electrum. And then, what do you do with a battery? You hook wires up to it. Ah, so here's now a wire, an electrical wire. Now, electrical wires, what are they made of? Usually the cheapest metal they can come up with. Ideally, they're made of copper, sometimes other wire, other metals. And those are conductors. So in that case, what is the potential of this wire? We've now made a continuous conductor. So it's 0V, 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 0V. What's the potential of this wire? 9V, 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 9V. So the key is that once you attach a wire to the electrode, it is a single metal. It's a single conductor. Two things touch, good enough. It's a single conductor. Remember the demo where we had the two spheres touching? We charged them by induction and then we pulled them apart. When they touched, they were like a single conductor. Charge was able to flow across. Okay, that's a battery. Done. See how we're going through so fast. Just a little bit of real world terminology here. We're gonna do some little circuits. Not today, next week. We'll do some circuits next week. Or maybe the next week. Or we can skip circuits, I don't know. Okay, so now here's what we're gonna do. This is exciting. Let's make a real world uniform field. Okay, a battery connected, I couldn't decide. Connected to two parallel conducting plates. Okay. I could have done this lecture in 5 minutes and written 5 equations and just circled them, but we're just going to get a feel for it. Okay, so here we go. So we're going to talk a lot about this drawing, and I'll keep erasing the right and keep reusing this drawing. Here we go. So here's a plate, okay, here, and here's a plate here. In reality, they would be big and close, but to be able to do the drawing, I got to make them, you know, farther apart so you can see what I'm drawing. So here is an electrode on the battery, and here is an electrode on the battery. Okay, this one is at 9 volts, this one is at 0 volts. And we're going to take a wire and connect it like that. Take a wire and connect it like that to those plates. Okay. What do you know? Let's see. What's going to happen here? What do you think these plates? Are they at a potential or where are they at? Let's see. Let's do some bullets here. Well, at first they were at 0 potential. But now you know this is conductor and this is the conductor and that's a conductor. So it must be now this is at 9 volts. And this is at 0 volts, okay. But how did they get from just neutral plates, presumably at 0 volts, both at 0 volts, how did they get to 9 volts? Like, how did this happen? So positive and negative, actually, I'm just gonna leave that off for now. Charge flows to the plates. Charge flows to the plates. If we start thinking about, did positive charge flow here, negative? That gets really confusing and weird. We might get into it later, but right now is not the time. So charge flows to the plates to create the potential difference. Delta V, okay? So they were at some potential, it doesn't matter. Charge flows to bring them at 9 and 0, this difference, okay? So that's how you can get that. That means we must have now. They're not neutral anymore. They're charged. So charge flowed, plates no longer neutral. And they're charged to Q and they have an area, right? So we have a charge density on the plates. And we know what happens when you have charged plates in the gap, you get electric field. So what we now have is field lines from high to low potential. So you usually, when you're drawing field lines, you imagine drawing them off of a charge, but you can also draw them off of a plate. Even if you don't draw these charges here, you can also just think in terms of potential. You have a little positive test charge, it's going to go from high to low potential. Anyway, so let's just draw our field lines. And this is how we make a uniform field, because we know that uniform fields are created by infinite charged planes. And we're assuming these are approximately infinite. Okay. So there, that happens. And what about the equipotential surfaces? Surfaces, what are they going to be? Well, we could say, let's make one in the middle. And if I'm a little test charge, short and stout, how am I going to move so that I don't have to do any work? It's like lazy time. They're going to move perpendicular to the field. You move against field, you got to do work. You slide along the field, you're going to have work done on you. So if it's like the weekend, you want to do this. That's how we know that equipotential surfaces are evenly spaced planes. Because equi means two things in between. Right? Equi means the potential is constant along here, but also we draw them spaced the same. Oops, let's see. I'll draw one there, and I'll draw one there. So we got one every quarter, right? 1/4 of the way, 1/2 of the way, 3/4 of the way, all the way. And the formula, or the dependence you can remember here, is that delta V is the electric field we've made times delta X. Okay, so there's some field in here, and you know, the whole gap is 9 volts, right? 9 volts, we could get the field delta X. Therefore, half the gap is 4.5. A third would be 3. Right? So we can start to fill these in, right? So if this is 9 volts and this is 0 volts, in the middle, 4.5 volts. What would it be here? That would be half, it'd be 2.25 volts. And 6.75 volts. So these planes perpendicular, or, well, they're, in the case, the equipotentials are parallel to the surface of the plates, which they have to be, because the surface of the plates have to be equipotentials too. So anyway, that's how it works. Your book has something that looks more like this, that the absolute potential equals ES. And all they mean there is they have said, well, let's make a coordinate system where this is S-axis, and we know that's zero. So in this case, delta X is just the same as S. And since you know where zero is, you don't need the delta on the V. Okay, so you see V equals ES. That's really all I'm saying here. Okay, is they're equally spaced. So now I'm going to erase upper bullets and start writing a few more. Make sure we cover everything here. Let's see. Now, it'd be great to be able to calculate this, but we need to know E. So how can we get E? You can get E from the charge density, if you know it. All right, so E, we recall, is sigma over epsilon naught. So for example, if you said a problem said you got two plates, each one is 0.1 meter squared, and a coulomb flows onto each one, plus or minus a coulomb, that's a way you could calculate sigma in a problem like that. Remember, sigma is the charge unit area. So it'd be the coulomb divided by 0.1 meter squared would be your sigma. So we know that's one way to get E, but you can actually get E a second way. E is also from potential difference and spacing. We also know, this is back when we calculated the work you gotta do, that E is the delta V over D, the separation. So I didn't label it, but this is the separation, usually called D. This was just an aside here, don't worry about that. Okay, so we have two ways we know E. That'll be important later. This one we got from thinking about work and the definition of what the potential energy and the potential are. This is from Gauss's law. I'm just telling you that's true. I never really proved that one to you, but you'll be okay. You'll get through life without knowing where that came from. Okay, so now we're going to do a quick problem using, again, this setup. I'll write it real fast. Just a quick calculation, just to make sure you're hanging in there with us, you know what's going on. It all makes sense. All right. So let's say an electron moves from the negative plate to the midpoint. How much potential energy U has gained or lost? Okay, right, so if the delta U is positive, it gained potential. If the delta U is negative, it lost potential. So we're just looking for delta U. Now let's think about this thing. We got this whole thing set up here, plus 9 volts, 0 volts, battery, that's all fine. You have an electron that's going to jump off the negative plate and move to there, and it's an electron. So there's different ways you could approach this. You could say, first, if you wanted to, you could think about, is it going to gain or lose potential? You could think about that first if you want. What are ds and delta x? S is an axis along here that I labeled as S. Usually you would call it X. I call it S because your book called it S. Sometimes your book uses S for distance. I don't know why. D is the physical separation. In this problem, it could be a millimeter. And X is the same as S. Yeah. Let's see. How much U is gained or lost? Yeah. So, which way is it? So is this electron going to gain or lose potential energy? One way to think about it would be, well, forget all this potential stuff. Does an electron want to leave? Like, you know, do you have to do external work to get the electron to go from here to here? No, right? The electron is negative. It doesn't want to be around all these other charges. It wants to go hook up with these positive charges. So this is a case where if you released it, there would be negative work done on it. The fuel would do work on it. That's internal work. So it is going to lose potential. Another way to remind yourself of that, if you released it from rest, it would speed up. By the time it got there, it would gain kinetic. If it gains kinetic, it must have lost potential. So we're definitely going to lose. Now the question is how much? How do we get delta U? All right. Now, what formula do we have for delta U? So you got to remember there's sort of two ways to jump to real things from last semester. F is QE, right? You take the charge times the field, but also delta U, what was our definition of delta V? It was delta U over Q, yeah. So delta U is Q times delta V. You want the real world force, Q times electric field. You want the real world potential energy, charge times the potential energy, or times the potential change. So in that case, delta U is, we just got to say, well, let's see, delta U is Q times delta V. So we just have to write these out. Delta U is U final minus U initial. That's the charge of the electron, 1.6 times 10 to the minus 19 coulombs. And delta V, it went from here to here, final minus initial. Well, we know the center point is 4.5 volts, right? 0 to 9, evenly spaced, uniform field. So the potential goes down linearly or proportional. So 4.5. So the final is 4.5, the initial is 0. So times 4.5. That's delta V, 4.5 volts. And this is negative. Trying to find my negative sign. There it is. Yeah, it's negative 1.6 times 10 to the minus 19. Cool. Right. And yeah, so this, if you want to go all the way, final minus initial. There you go. Okay. So you can see, I didn't really need to write final minus initial. We're just looking for delta U, right, is negative 1.6 times 10 to the minus 19 times 4.5 volts. And that'll be in joules. Right? So that comes out to minus 7.2 times 10 to the minus 19 joules. Okay, so an electron moving from the negative plate to the midpoint, how much potential energy is gained or lost? You're going to lose 7.2 times 10 to the minus 19 joules. Very straightforward calculation. Just get through the ideas of it. If you saw it at first and I didn't give you D, you might panic that you don't have D. So half of you would panic because you don't have D. Half of you would panic because you didn't use D. See, we can't win. We're not trying to trick you. There's more than one person taking the class. I know. Okay, so, but another thing I want to tell you about this is that's a ridiculously small number of joules. Okay, so there is a microscopic energy unit. It's a little confusing. Let's think about that. What is a joule in this case? How do we get a joule? Here I'm talking about units. We get joules by multiplying, in MKS, joules by multiplying charge times volts. So a joule is 1 coulomb times 1 volt. Okay. If we want to go microscopic, what we could do is say, why don't we just think in terms of the fundamental electric unit, I forgot what it's called, ESU, electric, fundamental electric charge, whatever it was. An electron is minus 1.6 times 10 to the minus 19 coulombs. A proton is plus 1.6 times 10 to the minus 19 coulombs. So that's an E. Remember from the very first when we started an E. And let's just keep the volt. And now we're more microscopic. All right. What is this called? This is an EV. So this is just a microscopic unit of energy. It's called an electron volt. It's a little unfortunate that we call it electron volt because electrons are negative, and you might think this is a negative one here, and they're inherently negative. They're not inherently negative. Just like E doesn't mean electron, it just means an amount of charge. EV doesn't really mean electron. It means an amount of energy. Okay. So really, this whole problem, then you look at it and you say, minus 4.5 EV, and you're done. Right? If you've been asked for it in EV. That's all there was to it. Okay, so that one's super trivial problem. I just managed to make it, I don't know if I made it sound hard or I'm trying to make it more clear by making it hard, I don't know. So the electron goes opposite to the electric field direction because it's attracted to the positive plate since it's an electron. Yes. So positive and negative charge behaves oppositely, right? So positive charge moves along the electric field, negative charges move against the electric field. Positive charges lose potential energy when they move along the field. Negative charges lose potential when they move against the field. If you release something, let it do what it wants, it loses potential energy. What can be tricky, quick aside, is if I have a positive, I don't want to make a mess here. Say I have two charges, positive and negative, at the middle, and I move them both to that electrode, what is their change in potential? It's the same. They're both going to a higher potential. The change in potential energy would be different. The positive charge would have more potential energy as it goes here. The negative charge would have less potential energy as it goes here. But the potential would be the same because the potential doesn't care about this charge, right? Doesn't care about the test charge, whatever it is. It depends on that. So that is something that people get tripped up on. If you're asked about potential or potential energy, it can affect the magnitude of what you're dealing with. 1017, we're doing good. Doing well. Sorry. We're doing good. All right. So now we've done all that, and we're ready to talk about the object. The object de lecture. It's basically this geometry. I've been tricking you. We've been talking about it the whole time. You were on Earth the whole time. Movie reference, who knows? Maybe you know from The Simpsons. Oh, wait, you're too young even for that. Oh, no. It was Earth all along. Nothing. Okay, that's fine. We're going to define two things real quick. A capacitor and another one, capacitance. Let's define these two things. This is the object. And I don't mean of the sentence. I mean, like, this is the thing that we're talking about. It's parallel plates that store charge in a circuit. So this is our first circuit element. This is a device. It's an object. You can go to a Radio Shack and buy one. Can't go to Radio Shack anymore. You can go to Fry's, but you can't go to Fry's anymore. Go to Amazon and you can order a capacitor. Okay, what is the capacitance? This is a property of the capacitor, right? It's the amount of charge stored for a given delta V. Okay. So you put some voltage difference on the plates, the capacitance is just how much charge is it stored. Because that's its job, is to store charge. All right. So let's look then at It's basically just an equation that tells you. Okay, so it is that the charge stored equals the capacitance times the voltage you apply. It's linear, it's proportional. It's just a straightforward, I should be, you know, bolding here, the big equations. Q equals CV. Put that in your mind, okay? That's the definition of the capacitance. Okay, so C is the capacitance in farads, named after the greatest scientist who ever lived, Michael Faraday, abbreviation F. And he would have gotten an F if he took this class, because he only had a middle school education. Let's see. So that looks trivial. There's some capacitor, I read its capacitance, I apply delta V, I get a Q. How are we going to make this hard? You don't know what you're dealing with. Let's see. So there's sort of two ways to deal with a capacitor. There's constant charge. Okay. So imagine you charge up a capacitor and just disconnect it from a battery, or it's just charged for some unknown reason, and you're walking around with it, all right? Well, then you would look at this, and you would say Q equals C. I'm going to leave off the deltas. Since we're doing circuits now, we can say always relative to the zero, or to ground. You can look at this and say the constant is the charge. So this capacitor, which we can draw now like this, this is kind of like the simple way to draw it, two parallel plates with electrodes attached to them. Probably goes to a battery later. But if I have a capacitor that's not hooked up, it's constant charge like that, that charge can't change. It's nowhere to go. So in problems, what could we change? Well, we could maybe change the capacitance. We can do things to it we're gonna talk about in a minute. And maybe that would change the voltage. So since this is constant, you could have like the capacitance could go up, then the potential difference would go down. And you could say, how could it go down? The battery is holding, oh, it's not hooked up to a battery. Right, so you can have capacitors that are constant charge situations when they're disconnected from battery. So I'm just trying to make it clear that this equation always holds for any situation. You could also have a constant delta V. So you can imagine this is if it's now hooked up to a battery. Right, what we were drawing before. It's constant delta V, but look at this equation. V, what's constant now? Hooked up to a battery, the delta V is constant. So if you had a capacitor hooked up to a battery and you wanted to get more charge, what do you have to do? Get a bigger capacitor. Or what if your capacitor got smaller? Oh, it went down. Oh, it's not going to hold as much charge. Okay, so both of them kind of make sense. Apply a voltage, you want more charge, more capacitance. The thing is holding a certain charge. If you raise the capacitance, this one isn't as intuitive, okay? But anyway, the point is the rule is always true. This is disconnected from battery. This is connected to the battery. So we'll have some problems where it's, you know, we're jumping between those two. So I'm sort of making that point now. Okay, so in the second half, we're going to talk a lot about capacitors and how to calculate capacitance. But now we need to take a break because we have so much more to do. It is 10:23. I will see you at 10:28. A region of the gas that's basically full of electrons and ions. And it's so full of those that it essentially becomes a conductor. And a huge current goes between the two. This is called an arc discharge. Or a lightning bolt is pretty much what you would think of it as. So this machine can actually make, first it can make a corona. You saw a picture of the corona. But then if I turn it fast enough, you'll make an arc. So if you get it going really fast. Oh, well, there's one. So you can see the arcs hopping between the two electrodes in the windmill machine. So this happens when the charge gets so big that it rips molecules apart in the air and makes a conducting path between the two. But it doesn't last, right? It's just a snap and it goes away. And the reason is that it discharges. So it takes a huge amount of charge on those balls, those electrodes, to cause this to happen. But as soon as that huge current flows by, then it's done. Okay? And sometimes they're very pretty. And it's fun to do. Now, for the final demo, for the sequence on charge,
I have taught for a while, and I know the main thing that students like to see is they like to see danger, and they like to see the professor in pain. That's really the main thing. So I'm going to use this for one more demo. I told you before that your body is a conductor. You're a leaky bag of salt water. So salt water is a conductor, ions can move, your body is mostly full of salty water. Your skin is wet, so you are a conductor. So if I'm a conductor, the lightning bolt should go through my finger. Okay, so I'm going to hold my finger in here, and we're going to send the lightning through. And I think on a few shots, you'll be able to see it literally going in one side of my finger and out the other. Sometimes it goes around, but it often goes through. So there you go. Now you're happy.
Whoa, that was close.
I'm glad I missed that one. All right, I'll see you in the next section.
Whoa, careful with that joke. It's an antique.
All right. I've got 10 seconds to go. Let's see. Okay. So, we talked about what a capacitor is. And of course, in physics, what we're going to do is calculate the capacitance. In electronics, you just read the capacitance off the side of the capacitor. But of course, this is physics, so we want to figure out what it is because somebody had to make the capacitor. Right? And be able to make one with a lot of capacitance, so somebody had to understand how it works, and that's us. And that's about to be you. So how do we calculate capacitance?
Find the relationship. Find relationships. Oh no, just between. I thought this was going to get exciting. Between delta V and, I'm going to write plus and minus Q. Just to remind you that every formula, anytime we say Q for a capacitor, we mean the amount of charge on each plate. We never mean it's double because there's Q on each plate, or it's zero because they cancel. It's just the charge on each plate. That's what Q always means. So let's do a little cartoon of a parallel plate capacitor here.
We can remind ourselves everything going on. All right, what do they got? They've got area A. What's the deal here? They're separated by a little d. Okay, one of them is positive. That's just a reminder that it's got positive charge on it. One of them's negative. They have field lines going across like this, like that. And the positive one must be at plus V, and the negative one must be at zero. So the potential difference across them is delta V, or you could just call it V or whatever. What else do we need to know? I won't bother, but you could draw the equipotential surfaces in there if you want. Okay, so to figure out C, the relationship between, you know, because remember, Q equals C times V, times delta V. One is you look at the relationship between E and plus or minus Q. This is the one that comes from like the Gauss's law, the thing we didn't go over. You just believe me that E is the charge density over epsilon naught. That's what we just told you and you accepted it, I hope. So then what is the charge density? It's the charge, oh, this has plus Q and this has minus Q over the area, right? So it's Q over A, that's the sigma, epsilon naught. So you can get the field inside the gap if you happen to know the charge and the area of the plates. Shouldn't it depend on D? You would think, but if you studied Gauss's law, you would know why it doesn't. Or you'd believe me that it doesn't. Part of it doesn't depend on D is these are infinite. So two infinite plates, it's irrelevant how far apart they are. Two, let's look at the relationship between E and delta V. This one you do know where it comes from. It's from that whole thing about the work it takes, you know, to get the potential energy and then divided by charge to get the potential difference. It's that delta V equals E delta X. We're just gonna write a little bit different. E equals delta V over here, the full delta X, or the full delta V is D. Right, D. So that is the D and the S and the X you're asking about. It's just this axis. It's named different things. So these are two ways we know to get at the electric field, either from charge or from potential. So now all we got to do is step three, equate E. I'm laying this out as steps because if we were talking about this more, we would talk about how to calculate the capacitance for other geometries. And this is the process. We're only going to do it for parallel plates, but I thought I would still show you the process. So Q over A epsilon naught equals delta V over D. Okay. So I could rewrite that and say Q equals, bring these up here, A epsilon naught over D times delta V. And what does that look like? That looks like Q equals CV, the capacitance times delta V. Because, let's see, so the capacitance we said was like a constant. Is this a constant? Yes, right? For a certain geometry, area is constant, separation's constant, epsilon naught's a constant. So this is how you calculate the capacitance. So, okay, so but for only a certain kind, okay? So for the parallel plate capacitor, C, and usually we rearrange it a bit, epsilon naught, property of the universe, and then geometry, A over D. Epsilon naught A over D. All right, so this is an important fundamental formula to remember. What's the capacitance of a parallel plate capacitor? Epsilon naught A over D. What if it's just two parallel plates that aren't hooked up to a circuit or anything? It's still epsilon naught A over D. Because what you'll notice here, there's nothing about charge, nothing about the electric field, nothing about the potential difference. This only depends on geometry. Capacitances are just geometrical properties of a couple of conductors. And then all the electric field potential stuff, that's once you start messing with it. Once you start putting charge on it, once you start applying voltages to it, putting electric field, whatever it is. But the actual object itself It's just epsilon naught A over D. That's all it is. Let's calculate one, just for fun. I'll leave that there, and we'll erase this over here. And let's calculate what is the what is C of 2, this is a capacitor that might be in your pocket, 2/4, 1 millimeter apart. And, you know, arranged facing each other, like two parallel plates. So here they are, 2 capacitors, 1 millimeter apart. You could hold them in your hand like that. What is the capacitance of that? Could we calculate it? I think we can. Here we go. Capacitance, epsilon naught, 8.85 times 10 to the minus 12. What is the area of both quarters? No, each quarter. Just like charge, area means each one. So pi, what's the radius of a quarter? Well, it's an inch, 25 millimeters, half is 12.5 millimeters. 12.5 millimeters is 0.0125 meters squared. Right? That's the radius of a quarter. Over D, 1 millimeter, 0.001 meter. Right? So you just run those numbers. You get something kind of small, right? 10 to the minus 12. And remember in those interference things, there's that trick where you could just do this part in millimeters because it'll cancel. That doesn't work here because this one is squared. Okay, so it's safest just to put everything in meters here. So a small number over a small number, still kind of a small number, 3, 10 to the minus 12. In the end, you get 4.3 times 10 to the minus 12 MKS unit for capacitance, farads. Okay, so every day, couple of conductors near each other have very small capacitances. That's why we use, you know, the little prefixes. 4.3 PF, picofarads. P equals pico equals 10 to the minus 12. The next one up, you aren't admitted to the university if you don't know that N is nano, 10 to the minus 9. The next one up is mu, micro, 10 to the minus 6. So you'll see picofarads, nanofarads, and microfarads will show up. And that's kind of the range of farads you can get into. All right. Let's see. How are we doing on time? 30, 40, 24 minutes. Yes. Let's see. Picofarads, pretty small. Let's say you wanted even more farads. Let me show you how they pull that off. All right. Here we go.
So let's see how they do this with capacitors in the real world. So here's a real capacitor. It's got 4.7 millifarads of capacitance. That's quite a bit compared to our 18 picofarad little capacitor, and it's a lot smaller. So to find out, the only way to find out is to start to take it apart. So let me begin to cut on this little guy here. The package comes off pretty easy. Let me see. There we go. So this is just a label. You don't need the label, that's for sure. And then you can start to see what's going on inside. Yeah, so you can see it's just a metal can. One side is actually grounded to the can or connected to the can electrically. This side isn't. This is the side we want to go after here. And we'll just start gnawing it apart with this thing here. And the edge comes off. There's got to be something good in here to get 4.7 millifarads going. Let's see. You could be watching funny cats, or you could be watching this. Really, I think this is better. Okay, so now I've got the can sort of open. Oh, this is some sort of an electrode here. Let me see if I can pull the assembly out. Ooh, it's wet. It's wet. That's interesting. There's this little band is holding it together. So let's get that little band off of it like that. And now I don't know what chemicals are getting on my fingers, but there's something wet on here. And now it may be alive. I'm not sure. Let's see. Let me get this piece to come off that piece. There we go. And now you can see it's starting to unwrap with wet paper. So we talked about water has a very high dielectric constant. So the acrylic we're using water is the gap inside the gap, and you can see the paper is the gap. So the paper is between these two gray electrodes. So there's one on this side coming off, and now there's one on this side coming off. And you can see they have the paper in between. So they've put a dielectric in the gap, and they want a really big gap. So here's the gap. It's these two electrodes, and it comes apart more and more and more and more and more and more. Look at that. Oh, it's still going. There it is, all the way to there. There's the whole capacitor. And there's an electrode on one side and an electrode on the other side. So that's how they get 4.7 millifarads in such a small package. Now I'm going to put it back together and we'll put it back in the computer I took it out of. So you can see that was a millifarad capacitor, 10 to the minus 3 farads. We just calculated something about that size, 10 to the minus 12. So that's, you know, 9 orders of magnitude. How did they get 9 orders of magnitude? Well, you kind of saw, you can make the area bigger by rolling something up, and you can make D very small. It's the thinness of a piece of paper. That'll get you partway there, and then the dielectric is the extra part. We're going to talk about the dielectric at the end. I just wanted you to see a real capacitor, and that's how it works. It's essentially a parallel plate. It's just rolled up. That part doesn't matter. As long as the two electrodes are really close to each other, that's how it works. Okay? So a capacitor, that's it. Problems are going to be silly things like, well, we pull them farther apart, D gets bigger. I mean, it's hard to break away from plug and chug here. We're going to do our best. All right. So you could calculate the capacitance now. I have confidence in you. The next thing is that, does a capacitor really store charge in a circuit? What's it really doing? It's really storing energy via charge. Energy stored in a capacitor by storing charge at some potential difference. It takes energy to make that, so they're really holding on to energy. And the fact that they do this is very clear to people my age. So I am old enough that I got to grow up and witness the birth of home computers. Okay, so this is my very first home computer. This is a VIC-20, okay? The computer is just the keyboard part, hooked it up to your television. It had 5 kilobytes of RAM. Yeah, does anyone want to guess how much hard drive storage space it had? Somebody in the chat, how big do you think the hard drive was? Anyone put a number, any guess? 1 gig, no, 4 gigs, four, one, zero! There were no hard drives in 1983. Didn't have a hard drive. Give me a break. There's no hard drive. So if you want to save something, like what you would do is you would type in a program, mess around with it, turn the computer off, and it was gone. And you want to do it again, you had to type the program in again. And then I got this little tape player. Then you could save a program to audio tapes. So you like erase your Van Halen so that you can save this program you just wrote. Pretty badass, I'm telling you. Pretty awesome. So the reason I'm telling you this is that, then I moved on here. Then I had an Apple II. Okay, this is getting serious now. So now you see I have a floppy disk drive, that thing on the right. And that'll hold like 256K. Big time. I was big time. Other people, well, I don't know, they were having sex or something. I was sitting here messing with this thing. And then I got this. 2 disk drives. That's the first time you could ever make copies of things. And everybody's like, I hear Hafner got 2 disk drives. Let's take all his discs to his house and copy them. And that's how we spend our evenings. Again, other people having sex. We were copying floppy disks. That's the 80s for you. That's my 80s experience. Why am I telling you this? I don't know. It might be therapy. But the reason I'm telling you this, is because these things had big-ass capacitors in them. That big one I showed you in that video, millifarad, those were in there storing energy, and sometimes they would explode. So it was fairly routine in the 80s, computer like this, you're typing along, pop! Huge explosion, screen goes dark, and literally smoke trickles out of your computer. And that's where the phrase pop a cap comes from. We were saying pop a cap long before it was used in popular music. So this would happen, you take it to the computer store and say, I popped a cap in my chass, you know, so then you'd have to deal with that.
And the reason is they don't just store charge, they store energy, and they store a lot of energy. And why do they store a lot of energy? Because they're holding charge Q at delta V, and that's what it takes to make potential energy. Okay, let's see. So you might even be able to look at this and say, I'm so good at this now. I know what energy it's holding. You must be holding Q.
Dr. Hafner?
Oh, yeah, sorry.
The picture's up. Yeah, thank you. The computer picture images are still on the screen.
Oh, I took it down. I missed. I hit the wrong button.
Yeah, there we go.
Yeah, so I thought I hit it. Thanks. So the whole Q at delta V, and you may think I'm smart enough to know the energy is just the Q times delta V, right? That's like the definition of potential, right? It's the U over Q, but this isn't quite right, okay? Then you say, oh, I know what it was. The problem is it's 2Q because we do have, so it must be that the energy they hold is 2Q delta V, and that's not right either, okay? So let's look a little bit. We mostly care about the formula. Those are both wrong. Why? Why are those wrong? Why are those simple ideas wrong? It's when the first charge separated, what was delta V? Two plates, no charge separation, they're neutral, delta V was zero. So you got the first charge for free, basically. The first charge is the first one to create any delta V. And the next one had a slightly bigger delta V. And the next one had a slightly bigger delta V, etc. So how do you think you're going to calculate this stupid total energy if delta V is changing? Yes, it's that the amount of energy you have for a charge depends on delta V for that little bit of charge. So we have to integrate to get the energy. Oh my God. Integrate all the delta U, or all the potential energy, to get the potential. I can do the left side. But now we're going to integrate all the charge from zero to Q, however much you're putting on it. Delta V, this is the key. Delta V is not a constant. Right? So if it was just a constant, then yeah, these would be the answer. But it's not a constant. What is delta V? It's the charge at the time over the capacitance. Capacitance is a constant. I got that going for me. Times dq, and now you can see there is actually an integral to do here. Q dq, which is 1/2 q squared over c evaluated from 0 to big Q. Okay, just took that integral of q, and then you plug in q. When you plug in 0, you get 0, so that part is easy. So u is big Q squared over 2c. That's the energy stored in a capacitor. But that's writing it in terms of the charge on it and the capacitance. You can actually write it two other ways, because you can write it in terms of Q and C, or Q and V, or V and C. I mean, you can kind of do all of these. So then you'd say, okay, another way to write it, and to jump between those, you'd say, okay, I want to write it like we're trying to do here, Q and V. So I need to replace this C with what? Q equals CV. So the C needs to be Q over V. So I put a Q down here and a V up here. So it would be Q squared over 2Q over a V there. So I'm just showing you the algebra, right? So it's 1/2 QV, right? We guess Q delta V or 2Q delta V. It's actually less than that. It's 1/2 Q delta V. And the reason is when you were putting a lot of the charge there at the beginning, there was no delta V. So it didn't take any work. You didn't put any potential energy in the system. And then finally, you could write it a third way. I will leave it as an exercise for the student. You could write it in terms of C and delta V. Okay, I'll give it to you. 1/2 C delta V squared. So all three of these are really the same formula. You're just using the definition of capacitance to jump between the three ways to write it. And which one you use would just depend on what you need from the problem. Do you have Q and C, or do you have C and V, or do you have Q and V? You could just memorize one of these and always use this. I mean, it's all meaningless. But the point is, you do hold a lot of charge. Or, I'm sorry, you do hold a lot of energy in capacitors. That's really like what they do. That's what they're for. All right. Capacitor, blah, 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 1049. Yeah, okay. So our last topic on capacitors, our last formula. So we're not many formulas here. We've got CV, or Q equals CV, parallel plate, C equals epsilon not A over D, and now we have the energy in a capacitor. So there's one more thing we got to do. Let's look at it. What about dielectrics? Dielectric. An insulator. Remember that I do need to tell you that dielectric is an insulator in a field, in an E field. So just like we talked about conductors, we can talk a little bit about what happens to a dielectric. Because you can imagine what we're going to do is we're going to put one inside of a capacitor. So we're trying to figure out what's going to happen. So just like the conductor, we have a dielectric here, put it in the field, what happens? It also gets polarized, just not as much. You get some polarization, and you have, like, if this is E naught, E naught is still in there, and you get a little E induced field. Okay. For a conductor, E induced would get so big it would cancel E naught. Okay, but for a dielectric, polarization lowers the field, inside the material, but not to zero. Okay, so you'd say then E inside equals E naught, like the E that you applied. And technically, since they're vectors, I would write it like this. E induced, like that. And I'm adding them because the vector definitions will make them the opposite direction. So E inside is lowered by E induced because these are opposite direction. But that's getting into the field theory of this that we're not going to do. What we do is we define a constant that describes the total effect. Okay, define a constant to describe the effect. And then that basically means you don't really need to know any of this. I'm just trying to give you some insight into what's going on. A dielectric constant will lower the electric field, and it's called K. It's called the dielectric constant. And technically, by definition, it's equal to E naught over E inside, okay? So it's big, right? This means you apply an electric field, the E field inside got smaller. So a big dielectric constant will mean it got really small, okay? That way it can become a big number. Okay, so K is that. It's called the dielectric constant. And it's just how much the field is reduced, kind of. It's like the ratio of how much the field went down. Okay, so let's see if we can guess a few values of the dielectric constant. Let's do K. What about space? If there's nothing to reduce the field inside, what do you think the dielectric constant of space is? 1, right? Nothing happens. What about air? Not a lot of matter in air. 1, okay. 0.0000, some teeny effect. But let's talk about some real things. Okay, here we go. I'm a teacher, I'm supposed to say the right thing. 1.0006 is there. What about K of, remember my Teflon rod? What about a typical like polymer plastic thing? 2.1. So, you know, a little charge separation, then here E inside is gonna get smaller. So if this is 2, then E inside is like half of E naught. So Teflon will cut the field in half. It's pretty good. It's not 0 though. What about water? 80. Oh my God, 80. Dropped it almost to 0, right? By a factor, almost, you know, factor of 80 lower. And the reason is water, the molecules of water, have a very large dipole moment, and they can rotate. Since it's a liquid, they can align with the field. So you get a huge polarization in water. So it's not a conductor. You know, you can't have the charge flowing. You don't have free electrons flowing like in a metal, but you can get so much dipole alignment that it can almost cancel the field. Okay, so maybe you can guess what that's going to do to a capacitor. It's going to make it go up. And maybe now you can guess why that capacitor I was taking apart was wet. They put water in it. That's why it's called an electrolytic capacitor. I'm getting ahead of myself, but we're also running out of time. All right. So look at this now. So let's say we put a dielectric in a capacitor and see what happens. So at the beginning, we had a capacitor like this. Let's talk about it again. Plus, 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 minus, 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 minus. We have plus Q over here. We have minus Q over here. We have delta V. All right, we have electric field, E naught, and we have a separation D. That's the capacitor we've been playing with all of our little equations. Now, let's put an electric field in here. I'm sorry, let's put a dielectric in here. Like that. What is that going to do? Is capacitance going to go up or down? Interesting question. Well, let's see. If this is the positive side, the electrode is positive. It's going to get polarized and get a little bit of positive charge over here and negative charge there like that. Right? So the dielectric is polarized. All right. Okay. Well, we'd say, okay, what's it going to do to the C? Well, the capacitance is the charge over delta V. Fine. We could say then that delta V is going to be the electric field times D. We could say, remember this, V equals E times D. Okay, so that's E naught. Now let's put in the dielectric. And what's going to happen? That's equal to Q. And remember, it's going to go down. It's E naught. Now we've got to put E inside there. So it's going to be E naught over K over the dielectric like that. So what you're doing is you're sticking K in the denominator of the denominator, which means you're multiplying by K. So it's equal to K Q over E naught D, which means it's equal to K times the original capacitance. Right here, this was C naught. So you have a capacitor with vacuum in it, calculate the capacitance, epsilon naught A over D, whatever you want to do. But if you fill it with a dielectric, it increases the capacitance. Okay. So that's why that capacitor, when we wanted to increase its capacitance, they put water in it. And that increases it by 80. But to increase it even more, they put salt water in it. That's what's called an electrolytic capacitor. It has electrolyte in it. So in addition to just the water molecules aligning, you have like some like sodium ions, you know, doing that. You have some chloride ions or whatever salt they use. And you get an even bigger effect. So an electrolyte has a K even bigger than 80. Get really, really big. Mm-hmm. And that's how they get the capacitance up. I went really fast at the end when I made practice problems. I have one silly video, but it's more than 2 minutes long, so I won't make you watch it. Yeah, I didn't do a lot of problems here with capacitance at the end, but there's not a whole lot to do. We'll find tricky ones there in the homework. We'll help you with them at office hours. Enjoy sprinkle days, and I'll see you next week.